We are back on Taking Care of Business on Current Radio News Talk, 1180, 1230 KGEO, 1410 KERI, and now in Albuquerque, New Mexico on 1000 KKIM, and also now in Richmond, Oakland, and the San Francisco Bay Area. We're going to take a turn here to a subject that's been very close to my heart and one I know Clay and I have spent a lot of time on in the past, and that's the POW-MIA issue. Our guest, former congressman and author, John Leboutillier. John, did I pronounce that correctly?
No, that's good enough, Marty. It's okay. Leboutillier, but it's Leboutillier. I mispronounce it. It's French. It should be Leboutillier, but I put the L's in there because we Americans say things better that way, so Leboutillier.
Leboutillier. Okay, I'm originally from Toronto, so I always have a hard time with French names for some strange reason.
that's funny.
So welcome to Taking Care of Business.
Thank you.
It's amazing to me. You and your former congressman friend Bill Hendon were on the IMA show about 5 years ago, and it blew me away talking about the POW-MIA issue, what you had to say. And again, this is an issue that's been close to my heart ever since I was in the Marines, you know, back in the late 60s, early 70s. But you claim, and I totally agree with you, that the Nixon administration intentionally left POWs in Vietnam?
Well, when we say intentionally, what happened was they didn't want to leave them there. They made the famous Paris Peace Agreement. And in the Paris Peace Agreement is a clause that says all POWs held in Southeast Asia will be returned to the United States. And in return for that, the United States is going to, quote, help heal the wounds of war, unquote, which in diplomatic parlance means we're going to pay reparations to North Vietnam. And Nixon, indeed, sent a letter to the Prime Minister Pham Van Dong of North Vietnam, February 1, 1973, where he spells out that we're going to pay them approximately $4.5 billion over a 5-year period.
And John, by the way, that
heal the wounds of war.
And John, by the way, that letter is online. After listening to your interview, I went online and searched for it. There's a copy of that letter online.
But for many years, Marty and Clay, that letter was denied by the government. So, no such letter ever existed. Well, of course it did. And that was the key to this issue, because we were supposed to pay that money to Vietnam, and then they would give us the prisoners back. Well, guess what? To this day, 40 and a half years later, we have never paid a dime of that money. We reneged on the deal. And they reneged on their half of the deal, which was to give us the other POWs. They did send one group home, as we all remember, when they came home with John McCain and Admiral Stockdale and Richard Stratton and all these famous guys came back, great heroes came back. Well, that was only half the POWs. The other half were still being held as insurance against this payment that Nixon promised. But who could foresee that Nixon would go down the drain in Watergate beginning that spring of 73, same time this is all going on? He's going down the drain. He secretly does try to pay, without Congress approving it, $100 million to get the prisoners back. And Vietnam says, no, we want the $4.5 billion. And so we never got them back. We've never gotten the prisoners back. They never got the money. We never got the prisoners back. And here we are, 2013, 40 years after that agreement, and this issue still exists. And by the way, the prisoners, some of them are still alive, being held against their will by the Vietnamese in prison camps in Vietnam and in Laos. They move them back and forth. And some of them are alive in the territory of the former Soviet Union under Russian control. Because during the war and after the war, Russia bought about 100 of these prisoners from the Vietnamese for their technical expertise in sonar, radar, rocketry, jet engines, missiles, all that type of thing. And they wanted their knowledge, and so they they traded military equipment to North Vietnam in return for about 100 American prisoners, some of whom are still being held against their will by the Russians.
Incredible. Our guest by phone, former Congressman John Le Boutier.
John, do you have any names of any of these individuals?
Well, I couldn't tell you that Joe Smith is here and Frank Jones is there. I have the list of all the ones that are missing.
Mm.
And in that list, I have another list, the U.S. government list, actually, of the ones that were seen alive in captivity in Vietnam and Laos and never came back. But do I know, which guy is where? I don't.
Well, but to expand on that a little bit, I know the conversation that you and Bill Hendon had and his book. Isn't there some people that, like in one case, there was a soldier who, what was it? It was 37-foot wide writing he did on a rice paddy with his evasion code number. So, we pretty much know that he was alive at one time.
That's right. Well, we do. Now that you say it that way, you're right. We have every pilot and airman. I don't know if this applies to infantry men, but when you go in an airplane, you're a pilot, a helicopter pilot, a crewman, each guy is given an authenticator code and an escape and evasion code. That's like today we all have our own PIN number for our bank account. And so I have my PIN number. If I write my PIN number out and you found it, you would know that's me, because it correlates to me. And we have several instances in the 80s and 90s, not that long ago, of these missing Americans putting their authenticator codes on tops of roofs in Vietnam and in the ground and in rice paddies over in Laos. And so, yeah, we have their names. Blair Rye is one of them, W-R-Y-E. He put his down. Another guy put his down in Laos with a walking K authenticator code, and we could get into the cover-up of that one. It's on the cover of Hendon's book called An Enormous Crime. There's a lot of evidence correlating to individual men.
Now, John, when you and Bill were in Congress, it was during the Reagan administration, and you said the Reagan administration lied, basically, and tried to cover it up. Everybody but, I guess, the only person who really wanted to get to the bottom of it was the president himself.
Oh, there's no doubt. And I had a meeting with the president. Hendon and I had one long Oval Office meeting with the president after Hendon and I had gone to Laos and talked to the Laos government about living POWs. So we thought that we ought to tell the president what was going on and get help. He definitely was into it, but underneath him were mostly alumni of the Nixon White House when it came to foreign policy and defense policy. And they all had already covered up this mess back in 73, 4, and 5. And I think they never really let Reagan know the full truth about this thing. That is the other big story. Number one story is that we left men behind, and the three of us have just talked about that. The second part of the story is that ever since then, the U.S. government has lied about it. They've lied to the country. They've lied to the families. They've lied to Congress when I was there. They lied under oath to the members of Congress that were investigating this thing, what they knew, who the men were, where they were. They lied about all of it. And that is why what's going on now, every time a new issue comes up, WMD in Iraq, chemical weapons in Syria, blah, blah, I automatically go, prove it. Because I don't trust anything our government says. And this isn't anti-Democrat or anti-Republican. It's anti-both. They all lie all the time when it suits their purposes.
And it always suits their purpose.
Well, not always, but I mean, most of the time, I think it does. This issue, it sure does. Yeah, no, you never hear anybody tell the truth about what happened and what is still happening.
Yeah.
I mean, my God, they are listening in to every phone call in America, the National Security Agency. We know that. Or if they're not listening, they're taping everyone, and they know of every phone call. And so if you call Aunt Mildred in Boise, Idaho, they have a record of it.
Yeah,
that's the level of espionage or monitoring that our government can do today in 2013. The idea that they don't know exactly who these prisoners are, where they are, under what situation they are, is absolutely laughable. Of course they know. And they made a conscious decision to do nothing about it, not to go public and say, my God, Vietnam is holding 250 prisoners. Instead, they stick to the same old line. We have no convincing evidence any men are there.
Yeah, crazy.
That's what they say.
When we come back from the break, let's talk a little bit more about some of the sightings and some of the people and other people involved in the story. We'll be back in a moment on Taking Care of Business on Current Radio News Talk 1180.